Hello friends, in this video I'm going to talk about how to play drums in a song. Okay, now this may seem silly to some more advanced players, but I've noticed it happening to a lot of guys that have a lot of chops but simply don't know how to function on the drum set, so in music. Okay, so also for very beginners, I want you to think about this so that you can sound musical. Okay, what is it to sound musical? It's to sound like you're playing music, not like you're just keeping a beat. Okay, so what do you need to know? I want you to think of the drums as a typewriter. Snare, the toms, the bass drum are like the keys, the letters, okay, which you're gonna speak with. The hi-hat is like a comma. Okay, the crashes are punctuation marks. And the ride symbol is like the shift key when you want to write in all capitals or you want to put capital letters on a phrase. Okay, so I want you to start thinking about the drums this way, as something you're going to speak with. Now, how do you apply that to music? All right, let's take a real simple structure, okay? Start with eight bars. Eight bars, okay? How do you approach eight bars? Have you ever heard that phrase, keep it simple, stupid? Well, you know, not only is that phrase insulting, it's really not useful, because the people I think that came up with that phrase were so frustrated with maybe musicians who didn't know what they were doing, you know? Anybody could get a record deal and do a record. And I think that's where they came up with that phrase. So there's nothing simple about playing music in reality. It takes a lot of concentration and a lot of artistry, all right? Not only do you have to dominate your body and to make it do what you want it to do, but you have to understand what music is trying to communicate, all right? So how do you approach simple eight bars? Let's say this is a pop tune, okay? And you just have to keep a real simple beat, all right? The biggest drag I hear is people doing like a fill every two bars or changing something every two bars, doing a variation. By the time you get to the end of the eighth bar, it's like completely lost the power of tension. Okay, the eight bars. Let's say a songwriter is trying to communicate something and he needs 16 bars, okay? He doesn't want the tension to be broken up every two bars. He wants you to aim for 16 bars. That's where there's gonna be a release of tension, okay? So what you have is my system, what I call the arches system, okay? Now, this is the first arch right here. I want you to think of playing from here to here, okay? The end of the eighth bar. Now, how do you do that? You have some options. At the end of the eighth bar, you know, the first thing you might think about is doing a crash, right? But in reality, a crash puts a punctuation to a phrase that might be longer than that, okay? Have you heard, you know, players playing, keeping that groove going and crashing every eight bars? Not very much, unless it's a rock tune or something real heavy like that. But I want you to get used to this idea so that you can create tension and release and be in charge of it, okay? Be in charge of it. Don't be at the mercy of your impulses to fill up the sonic space with noise, you know? That's I think what happens a lot. If there's a tendency to want to, you know, you get excited and you want to fill up the space with noise. Nobody wants to hear that, okay? So you aim for the eight bars, all right? Another way you could do that is simply doing a hi-hat variation. You know, you've all heard hi-hat openings. Okay, that's one way that you can mark this structure. It takes a lot of concentration to keep the same thing going for 8 bars and not do anything until you reach here. Part of the object of drumming is to help keep the musical structure, okay? So the musical structure of this phrase is 8 bars, not 2 bars, not 4 bars, it's 8 bars. However, you can, if you want, break up this thing here and make it 4 and 4. Okay, now if you want to do 4 and 4, most likely the simplest thing would be the hi-hat variation here. Okay, and here you would do a bass drum variation. Okay, so let me just sing that for you. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay? That's how you communicate structure with drums. You don't go randomly doing stuff wherever, okay? You have to create an arc and use the drums for the purposes that they have in each style of music, okay? Now, let's say you have 8 more bars, okay? 8. You have another arc here. You can break up the, you know, 4 like that again and do this same thing here. But now that you have 16 bars, you know, your task is like enhanced in difficulty because you have to keep this arc, okay? 16 bars, not 8 and 8, but 16, all right? So next time you want to use one of these things, you have to think carefully of what you're trying to do, okay? So, and that's why I broke it up like this, hi-hat variation, and then a bass drum. I can spell BD. Variation, okay? You have to start thinking about manipulating the structure and using the drums to help delineate the structure, all right? So now, you have 8, 8, 16, you have 1 arc, 2 arcs, and 1 bigger arc across the 16. You want to aim for 16, okay? Keeping this and this constant helps you to create a 16-bar structure. Now, this is a common, let's say, a common pop tune, okay? And then the next thing you're going to probably have is a 4-bar pre-chorus, okay? In the old school terms of writing pop tunes. And then you're going to have 8 bars of chorus. Okay? Now, not only do you have 1 arc, 2 arcs, you have another one here and another one here, all right, that you have to get across. What are you going to do on this section? What are you going to do in this section? All right? Well, to make it different than all these, you can do a slight variation on the hi-hat, for example. Instead of the whole time 8th notes, you might want to do a little variation. Maybe this. Okay? To give it a little bit of different texture. Okay? But you want to aim for these 4 bars. Then here comes the chorus. Here you can do a crash, perhaps, to go into the chorus. All right. Now, in the chorus, what happens? It's the hook of the song. So the hook of the song, you want to make it stand out from these other things. If you want to be real blunt about it, you can go to the ride cymbal. But I would save the ride cymbal for later. You're going to see why. Okay? Because after, you know, you get to the ride, you can't go any higher than that. You know, you can do some ride variations and stuff, but to really keep the tension moving, you're going to have to use other tools that you have at hand, okay? So, you have your original pattern that you're keeping here. Here you can do a pattern variation. Slight pattern variation, okay? Maybe just something on the snare. So you're playing dot dot dot. Here you can go something to give a little variation to differentiate from here to here. Okay, so what do the verses do in music? The verses are to prepare for the chorus, all right? And the pre-chorus is like a preview of the chorus, something that gives more energy towards the chorus. So not only do you have this arc, but you have this entire arc that goes all the way to here, okay? Till the end of the pre-chorus. That's why we did a crash here to separate that. Now you have this whole thing also from here till the end of the chorus, okay? So you have one enormous arc from the beginning to the end of the chorus, all right? All that needs to be created with tension. If you do fills every two bars, crashing every two bars, whatever, just blatantly ignoring musical structure or not having a clue of what you're doing about this, people are gonna say, hey man, what are you doing? Can you play the song? You know, that's why Keep It Simple Stupid was invented, I think, because people got so frustrated with musicians just not understanding some basic musical concepts and what the function of their instrument was, that they just said, man, just play this the whole time. Just stay there, don't play anything else. Keep it simple, stupid. And that doesn't serve anybody, okay? Now, you have to understand this in order to create tension and release, all right? The tension, release, okay? The end of the chorus. Now, what happens usually? Sometimes you go back to the verse, or maybe there's a two-bar little interlude, something, and you go back to the verse again. But this time, maybe you only do 8 or 12, some little compositional trick, and you go back to the pre-chorus, and maybe this time it's 2 instead of 4, or maybe even 3, okay? So you have to keep your concentration to outline 3 bars in the same manner that we did before, okay? Then you have the chorus again. The second chorus is perhaps a little longer. So you have to be aware of how long the second chorus is gonna be, okay? Sometimes instead of 8, it's 12, you know? Then you're gonna have a guitar solo. Maybe it's 4 bars or some kind of a solo. And there is where you can go to the ride, okay? This, you wanna play these 4 bars, and here you're gonna ride, because the guitar, you wanna bring it up. You wanna, in the solos, you wanna make the song big. You wanna make it big. And then most likely you're gonna go back to the pre-chorus and then to the chorus, then out. All right, this is a real simple song structure, but I wanna make you see what the function of the drums are, okay? So at the end of here, you're gonna do a crash, all right? To come in, and maybe here on the way out, you're gonna do a crash again. All right? Not in the middle of the pre-chorus, not in the middle of the chorus, but at the end of the chorus. And you're coming into the guitar solo, here's a crash, and then going out of it is another crash. You outline the sections of the solo. You punctuate where it starts, where it ends. Okay, now, another thing you have, I'm gonna erase this real quick. So another tool that you can use is dynamics. Everybody says, oh, dynamics, you know, you gotta have dynamics. So what the heck do you do with it, actually? All right, so let's say we have 32 bars, okay? In these 32 bars, we're gonna apply all those concepts we just did. You're gonna have the breakup of the different sections, but dynamically, you wanna do this, okay? Do you have the control, the self-control, to go from one volume and make it bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger until the end of 32 bars? Can you make it go from one volume to slightly higher across a whole 32 bars, to play with more intensity at the end of 32 bars? That takes a whole lot of concentration, pacing, timing, okay? Dynamics. If you want to make it exciting when you get to the chorus or the guitar solo, whatever it is, you're going to use dynamics in this way. Now, let's just say dynamics, okay? You're going to go back to the next part of the song, and they're probably going to tell you, okay, come down again, right? But do you want to come down to the original volume of the beginning of the song? Maybe, maybe not, okay? It all depends. But you've got to be aware of this, okay? All right. This is what you might even consider microdynamics, all right? Now, another thing that you can do to create more tension, you use what I call stacking voices. What does stacking voices mean? It means, for example, if you're doing a beat, you start to add ghost notes so that the hi-hat and the snare notes are stacked together. What this gives is more body, more push, more texture to the groove, okay? If you leave the groove open the whole time, real simple, it's gonna sound like a drum machine, right? What you wanna do is stack the voices. Another way to stack voices simply, if you wanna do it simply, is just do a slight open, you know, slightly take the pulse with your leg on the hi-hat so that it doesn't necessarily open, but it just barely opens so that you can just feel that opening, whether it's eighth notes or quarter notes or whatever. Okay, that's gonna help to add the stacking to the voice. Very subtle, okay? Microdynamics. Can you keep that through a whole structure, like another 32 bars, right? Ghost notes, bass drum variations, okay? Different textures in different parts of the song. And finally, fills, all right? Fills, where do you do fills? You don't do fills in the middle of each verse or something. You do them at key points in the musical structure. So just to make things simple, let's say you have 32 bars. For some reason, you're playing a TV commercial or whatever. This is where you do the fill, unless it's marked, you know, somewhere else. There's something going on. You do a fill to mark the structure of the music, okay? 32 bar structure, that's where you do the fill. The part of the function of fills is to delineate transitions, okay? So you're talking, you're talking, you're talking, you do a fill, here comes the next section. Okay? That is the function of fills and why you do them before each section. If you listen to great drummers, they know this, okay? Listen closely to what's going on, and you'll see that this is what's going on. The stacking voices thing should not be heard, more felt, okay? And the reason we have hi-hat variations and bass drum variations is not so that you can play a million beats. It's so that you can use them at the appropriate time to create tension and release by adding, or let's say, creating more texture in different parts of the song, okay? This is a lot more complicated than telling somebody, keep it simple, stupid, but sometimes you're, you know, people are in the studio and they didn't have time. Studio, $100 an hour. Hey man, just play this. And that's all. Don't play anything else. That's the only way you can communicate to some people, right? And I think it does a disservice to music and the song. But if you have no experience, you know, how are you gonna learn this? Somebody has to tell you. Okay, so if you wanna know more about this, I talk about it a lot on my website, on my lesson site. All my material from Inner Clock 2, you know, I talk about this. I tell you where to put fills, what to do with the structures and stuff like that, where the changes go, when to go to the ride, when to go to the hi-hat and all those kind of things. Those are very important orchestration issues that you have to get used to. You know, you're not just keeping a beat on the song, okay? That's not the drummer's job. The drummer's job is to do all these things that we talked about, therefore, to play music. You're a musician, you play music, you know, just robotically like a zombie, keep a beat for some guys, okay? Now, I hope that's all clear. If you have any questions about that, please drop me a line, write in the comments here. I'll be glad to answer any question you might have. Remember that this all varies from musical style to musical style. But what we have with the Archer system is it gives you an overview, okay, of where to put things and how the tension is spread out over time, okay? 32 bars, that's the tension. If we had smaller segments, okay, these would be the arches, all right? And this would be the arch and that, and then all of it, okay? So that's what drumming is about, playing music. Being a musical drummer is a very, very important thing. Nothing to do with chops, okay? Nothing to do with stick twirling and or showing off and stuff like that. If you can do this, people will love playing with you and you will make money, okay? All right, remember to join the lesson site. Only 150 bucks gets you in the full year program. Tons of material, tons of play-alongs, all my stuff on the lesson site. Hope to see you there. Peace out.